So welcome to tonight's holiday edition. Pleasure as always to be here with you. And when I was thinking about the holiday edition and feeling really, like I said, tonight's energy feels very holy. So oftentimes the energy I transmit is a certain flavor and tonight feels very holy. Very holy. And so sometimes when energy feels holy, sometimes gotta get a little biblical. I was thinking about, actually, this is funny. I was thinking about the Bible the other day. I don't know why. I think about weird things. The Bible is not weird, but I was thinking about this interesting thing about the Bible. So I go, okay, the Bible is like this big book with all these stories written by a collection of authors, and each one offers a parable with some sort of transformational wisdom encoded in it. And I thought, that makes the Bible like the first chicken soup for the soul. Totally. It's the very first chicken soup for the soul. A little cryptic. And when I was thinking about the holiness of tonight's transmission, I really wanted to share with you an experience I had, because many times I will share a lot of the realizations I've had and the experiences of awakening I've had throughout my life. And so often I have so many different experiences that I forget the experiences I've had. I'm left with the insight of what came to me, but I forget the experiences I've had. And then I remember, like, years later, and I go, oh, obviously I meant to share that for the benefit of all that I'm sharing this with. So tonight I want to share with you an experience that I had many years ago. And it's amazing, because when you awaken in consciousness, a lot of people could say you're waking up out of the dream of ego. And what's amazing is when you can have an experience that helps you wake up out of the dream of ego, but you can have those kind of experiences while dreaming at night. So imagine an awakening so powerful that it helps you wake up in the middle of a dream. And I had one such experience where I went to sleep one night and I had a very vivid dream that was an awakening. That as I woke up from the dream the next morning, my life was changed forever, just as it has in every awakening I've experienced. And again, just as a reflection of what's already happening and going to continue to happen within your life. I'm simply a reflection of what's already unfolding and what will continue to unfold for you. And I'm simply here to coax that to the surface and accelerate it for the evolution of your being. And I had a very profound experience that for me, in my own experience encapsulates the holiness of the holiday season. I want to share that with you. And I think along the way you'll see how it relates to your journey. So I went to sleep one night many years ago. And it was a different kind of a dream. Most dreams I've had in my life, and you probably know what I'm talking about, where you're like the main character in the dream. And people are talking to you, and everything's kind of a first-person point of view. But this was a dream where I wasn't actually the character in the dream. I was actually the observer walking beside the characters in view. Kind of like in a movie theater, but I wasn't in a theater watching it from afar. I was in the scene. And in this dream, there was the feeling sense that there was this soul who is about to go through their spiritual initiation. And that soul was approached by Jesus. And I share this with you because throughout my life, I've had many vivid, direct experiences with Jesus. And in my own experience, instead of it being like something I'm not or something above me, Jesus has always, in my direct experience, before I knew anything about spirituality or any of this, the sense I always had was that Jesus was a reflection of my own potential. that I was interacting and communing with my own highest potential, just as you are opening up and communing with your highest potential, whether appearing as a guide, an angel, the light of consciousness, or the universe itself, whatever you want to call and refer to it as. So all of my experiences with Jesus, and this was as I started talking about my experiences with friends and family at a very young age, I quickly realized that it wasn't somehow being raised in a Jewish family talking to Jesus was like I was a kid at Disneyland who cut in line for a roller coaster. That's how I was treated. Like, you're not supposed to do that. And my amazement was, why am I not supposed to do the things that come to me first? I didn't go towards it. It came to me. First time I had an experience with Jesus when I was about 8, and I talk about this in a lot of my interviews because everyone asked me about it, I didn't even know who Jesus was. I just knew the being, the feeling, the face, the look. And then I saw some painting in my friend's house and said, who's that? Because that's who I met in my dream last night. My friend's like, Matt, you did not meet Jesus. Well, look, I don't know what his name is. That's who I met. I don't know why this is so ridiculous.
That was your out-of-body experience.
That was my out-of-body experience when I was about 8 years old. That's part of what activated all of this and led me to where I am today with you. And, you know, when I've had experiences with Jesus, there's always been a reverence, but there's always been an inherent equality. There's never been, I never had this experience of like, oh, above. It was always a reflection of that which I am. On some level, I always knew that. So it was very interesting. So I had this dream, and I'm watching this soul, and I have this intuitive sense. This soul is about to go through an initiation. And you know when you have dreams, and you don't even stop to think about it, you just go with it? Like, you don't stop to go, what initiation? You just go with it. And here comes Jesus. And Jesus says to the soul, for your initiation to unfold, I'm going to show you something. And Jesus asked the soul, are you ready for your journey? And the soul excitedly said, yes, I am. And literally, the moment the soul said, yes, I am, it was like, shift scenes, now we're somewhere totally different. We're no longer in a heavenly landscape. We're now in a dark cave. And it's Jesus walking beside this initiated soul. It was dark. It was cold. You could hear echoes of shrieks and screams. And very quickly, you get this, the feeling sense, the visceral sense that this is some sort of hell realm. And I'm not someone who was raised with a fear of these kinds of things, but when you experience something like that, within a split second, you know where you are. And I knew where I was watching all of this. And Jesus and the initiated soul walked side by side through hell. And from the perspective of the initiated soul, there was like these dark, demonic, tortured souls, like out of the corners of shadows, like reaching out and barely missing the feet of the soul as they would walk forward beside Jesus. And on Jesus' side, every step Jesus took forward, any of those reaching, grabby, darkened hands pulled back and stepped away. And Jesus said to the initiating soul, if you trust and know the light that I am that walks beside you, the darkness will part. And the initiated soul started to trust in the word of Jesus. And on both sides of this walkway in this darkened cavern, a path started to open up, and the shrieks and screams got more faint and more distant, and the hands and the claws and these really grotesque things started to move back. And Jesus kept saying, if you trust and know the light that I am that walks beside you, the darkness will part. And as the initiated soul was walking with Jesus, then there started to become this curiosity or wonder, what are these souls? Who are they? Why are they here? And as those kinds of concerns and curiosities started to arise in the mind of the initiated soul, the darkness started to come back. And Jesus would say, if you trust and know the light I am that walks beside you, the darkness will part. And then a path would be cleared. And the soul says to Jesus, if you are who I know you to be, why aren't you freeing all these souls that are here? And Jesus points in the distance, and there's a pinhole, like a pin drop of light in the distance, and said, do you see that light in the distance? And the soul said, yes. And Jesus said, that's the doorway to heaven. The door is always open. These souls have the free will to enter the light. They're choosing to be here. And Jesus said, I cannot liberate, I can only remind one of their choices. And Jesus put out his hand and said, are you ready to be guided? And the soul said yes and grabbed Jesus' hand, and Jesus starts guiding this soul deeper and deeper into the darkness, where that light seemed further away, started to flicker, and there was a moment where that light vanished, and there was nothing but darkness on all sides. And that initiated soul started to get very, very panicky. And as that soul started to get panicky, Jesus kept moving forward, the soul froze in place, and Jesus kept walking and walking, and eventually Jesus vanished out of sight, and this initiated soul was now in hell, not knowing what to do, alone with itself. Alone with its curiosities, alone with its concerns, alone with its fears, alone and as that initiated soul sat alone with itself, fear arose. Loneliness arose, sadness, the feeling of being rejected or abandoned. Why did Jesus leave me? And those screams got closer, and the arms reached out, closing in on this initiated soul, and just when it was like the darkness is about to swallow, this being, Jesus emerges again. And the soul says to Jesus, why did you leave me? And Jesus said, I kept moving forward. You let go of my hand. That was your choice. But I have come back for you, if you choose to come with me. And Jesus said once again, if you trust and know the light that walks beside you, the darkness will part. Jesus reached out his hand. The soul grabbed his hand and walked with Jesus side by side. With Jesus being the light guiding one out of darkness, but the initiating soul being the one who exits the darkness and enters the light when they find the power and conviction to choose to do so. Representing the partnership of personal will and divine will, divine will being the guardian and guide that will come into any amount of darkness and despair and bring you into the light when you use your personal free will to choose the light that will always come for you. And there's many perspectives to the story. I'm telling you, that was a dream I had. And as I came out of the dream, I realized something quite significant. From one perspective, you can think of the initiating soul being left by Jesus and then Jesus coming back. But in reality, that initiating soul was actually an aspect of Jesus from a previous chapter of incarnation, that Jesus was and is the future self of each and every initiating soul. And it was, in fact, the archetype of Jesus that was traveling back in time to rescue itself from the darkness, to re-experience how it had become the master it has always been. So imagine this, and let's apply it to your life in more profound ways. Do you want to know why most people have the rather difficult experience of sensing the light that walks beside them? Because it would be so easy to say, if I could feel and sense the light that walks beside me, then I would allow the darkness to part, right? But do you want to know why it's so hard to sense the light that walks beside you? Because in the dream, the metaphor is Jesus as an archetype of your future self, highest consciousness, is walking beside you. But a manifestation, a character, is the play, which means the play is showing you reality, but in a different way than it actually is. The light doesn't actually walk beside you. It walks and dwells within you. So the reason why many don't sense the light that walks with them side by side, because the metaphor of Jesus and the initiated soul side by side is the personal self and the will of the divine merging together in integrated, or I say holy matrimony, which is the full embodiment of awakened consciousness, where the initiated soul and the archetype of Jesus or any ascended master merge together to become divine perfection in human form, which is exactly the journey each and every one of you are on. Some of you know you're going through the throes, the depths of your initiation, on your own individual vision quest, waiting for the light of your highest glory to return for you. And some of you are starting to get onto the fact and know that you are actually the future self stepping back into the past, only to recover an aspect of yourself that forgot it is already holiness in form, divine perfection by nature. And one of the biggest hiccups in the spiritual journey are the assumptions of what you must do, what you must check off your list, what you must do correctly, like some sort of spiritual decathlon before you can become the light that you already are. And I will tell you that that decathlon, that labyrinth, that obstacle course will go on forever and ever and ever until you stop and declare that you are already the light of all, and you declare that now. and the words that bring forth the light of your highest consciousness to rescue you from any realm of hell or purgatory, to guide you out of darkness into the light of clarity. Those magic words that bring you that guidance, that allow the light that walks beside you to be realized as the light that dwells within you, are declared by the words, "I am the light I am." Some of the most holiest words that are actually a command the universe utters to itself as you. And in so many words, "I am the light I am" means enough of this crap. Enough of this striving and earning, and I got to do all these little things. Learning all the choreography that you have to memorize and get perfect in order to go to the next level is true when you take a karate class. Right? You do these moves, you break some boards, here's a belt. Now you come on Tuesdays instead of Mondays. Welcome to level 2. Your belt's purple now. Here's a stripe. Have someone sew that on your belt for you. And if they refuse, you know what to do. That's karate. I took it when I was 8. I remember that. 10, 8. What, so I took karate when I was younger.
I did too.
Yeah, it was fun. Loved it. Great. So much fun.
Loved it. Stripes.
Most entertaining 2 weeks of my life. Let's call it a rendezvous, right? I had a rendezvous with karate. I had a little taste of karate. It was a sample, basically. It was basically like a Groupon of karate. But in the spiritual path, we have to really get out of this mindset of, here's what I have to do to become the light. Because your journey will go on and on and on for as long as you maintain a belief that you are something other than the light. So let's start what I call closing the gap. Let's eliminate the distance between you and heaven. Because if there's any distance between you and heaven, you're in some form of hell. That's the razor's edge of this journey. Why can't people find heaven? Because there's no distance between you and it. In order to find something, there has to be distance so you can go from where you are to something else. No distance, no wonder you can't find it. You'd never go to someone and say, "Draw me a map so I can find myself." And they'd go, "How about this? How about this? Does this help you? Is this a good enough map? How about this? How about this? How about that?" No distance. So let's close the distance. Let's declare the light. Because there is a healing journey. There is a spiritual journey. But it doesn't have to go on and on and on and on. Your real journey is serving the universe by allowing the universe to serve you. Doesn't that sound nice? Right? Not this, "I'm going to work on endless things and just apologize for existing." So try this out loud. The light that walks beside me.
The light that walks beside me.
Is the light that dwells within me.
Is the light that dwells within me.
This means. The physical body.
The physical body.
Is not less than or other than.
Is not less than or other than.
The light of divine perfection.
The light of divine perfection.
The body is a manifestation.
The body is a manifestation.
Of divine perfection.
Of divine perfection.
And when I begin declaring that.
And when I begin declaring that.
My body will start to function.
My body will start to function.
Divinely and perfectly.
Divinely and perfectly.
The mind. Is not other than or less than.
Is not other than or less than.
The light of divine perfection.
The light of divine perfection.
The mind could only be.
The mind could only be
a manifestation of divine perfection.
A manifestation of divine perfection.
And when I declare,
the mind is a manifestation.
The mind is a manifestation of divine perfection.
Of divine perfection.
The mind begins acting.
The mind begins acting.
And operating.
And operating.
Divinely and perfectly.
Divinely and perfectly.
The ego.
The ego.
Is not less than or other than.
Is not less than or other than.
The light of divine perfection.
The light of divine perfection.
It only seems that way.
It only seems that way.
Because we've been trained. To call it something other,
to call it something other
than the light of divine perfection.
Than the light of divine perfection.
If it exists, it could only be a manifestation.
It could only be a manifestation
of divine perfection.
Of divine perfection.
And when I declare it is so,
and when I declare it is so,
it operates divinely and perfectly.
It operates divinely and perfectly.
So maybe the reason why things are the way they are, is to give me endless things to work on.
Is to give me endless things to work on.
As I insist that it is other than.
That it is other than
the divine perfection that it is.
The divine perfection that it is.
And this will go on.
And this will go on.
For as long as it takes.
For as long as it takes.
For me to start referring to things.
For me to start referring to things.
As the divine perfection that it is.
As the divine perfection that it is.
And in a moment that tests my faith.
And in a moment that tests my faith.
I will refer to it as divine perfection.
I will refer to it as divine perfection.
And it will still act the way it acts.
And it will still act the way it acts.
Just to see if I really am true.
Just to see if I really am true.
In honoring the divinity and perfection that it is.
In honoring the divinity and perfection that it is.
But when I take the leap.
But when I take the leap.
And declare.
And declare.
That anything and everything.
That anything and everything.
Could only be the holiness of divine perfection.
Could only be the holiness of divine perfection.
No matter how it acts or seems to be. Even at the risk,
even at the risk
of turning away,
of turning away
from being on guard,
from being on guard,
and risking the entire world going crazy,
the entire world going crazy,
because I wasn't spending every moment of my life,
because I wasn't spending every moment of my life
micromanaging the crap out of life. If I could dare,
if I could dare
to declare everything,
to declare everything
within and throughout me,
within and throughout me
as the light of divine perfection,
as the light of divine perfection,
no matter how it acts,
no matter how it acts,
to test the will of my highest faith,
to test the will of my highest faith,
if I stay
staunch, consistent
and unwavering. In that declaration, I will begin calling to me, within and throughout,
the highest qualities
and divine characteristics
of myself and others.
Now that I'm no longer playing a game,
as if anything.
Is less than the light of divine perfection.
Is less than the light of divine perfection.
And in doing so,
I assist the world.
In awakening to this truth.
In awakening to this truth.
As I dare to shine my light.
As I dare to shine my light.
Without waiting for the world to wake up first.
Without waiting for the world to wake up first.
And in shining my light.
And in shining my light.
Others are pardoned.
Others are pardoned.
Darkness dissolves.
Darkness dissolves.
As I remember and realize.
As I remember and realize.
Who I truly am.
Who I truly am.
That dwells in all.
That dwells in all.
As the eternal light.
As the eternal light.
Of divine perfection.
Of divine perfection.
Now and forever, amen.
Now and forever, amen.
Feel that? Yeah. Holy. Returning your attention to the truth of holiness that dwells in all. And when people are not acting of their highest holiness, it's just showing you a being on their journey that has not remembered its true essence yet. One who still acts out the immaturity of a seed and has not fully grown into what it means to be a flower. So by returning our consciousness to the realization of holiness, it frees us of the crap. Which is why the phrase is holy shit. It's true. That one came to me like a minute ago. I'm like, oh, build it up. Here we go. Build it up. Here we go. Build it up. The sacred phrase to remember your true nature is I am the light I am. And here's how backwards, again, nothing of any kind of teaching that I refer to or that is referred to as old paradigm, it's not like you shouldn't have learned this. It's just not relevant anymore, right? A lot of us have experienced of various grades, you know, first grade, second grade, third grade. Some of us skipped a few grades. Not me. Not me. I had a few friends that skipped grades. That always fascinated me. How awesome is that, to skip grades? But just like in that analogy, you have completed third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade, but you don't hang on to the textbooks that you read in third, fourth, and fifth grade and refer to them from time to time. Right? So spiritually speaking, this is the same thing. When I say old paradigm, I'm just saying that's not relevant anymore. It was good when you were in third grade or fourth grade. And again, there are people right now in the world in the third grade. And for them, it's highly resourceful and useful, right? There's no judgment about grades. Every grade, like your spiritual evolution, is a step in a staircase that doesn't bring you to heaven, but brings the realization that you are heaven into your consciousness. So it seems like you're going up steps, but it's really an inward remembrance that you are the light of divine perfection, that the only reason you can see a physical body is because it's woven out of the thread of divinity. The only reason you can see other things is because it's molded out of the clay of divinity. You want to think about like thread or clay or whatever it is. Thoughts woven out of the thread of divinity. Just expressions of divine perfection. And if you didn't have the tendency to judge yourself as less than the divine, you'd have some more useful thoughts going on. This is a genius machine. But when you have a low self-esteem, when you forget the glory of perfection that you are, then a lot of your thoughts tend to be as limiting and stifling and annoying as you have come to be annoyed by your own limiting view of yourself. So if we raise the bar of how we view ourselves, if we return with the universe and when we join the universe in honoring you the way the universe always does, then you will begin living as the universe you already are. The spiritual crisis is that you are all spiritual masters denying the truth of your being while insisting on doing things that no one is requiring you to do to remember who you've always been. You don't have your fifth grade notebooks anymore, so there are some teachings that we can just say, thank you very much, moving on. Because at the end of the day, there are some outdated paths that serve their time and place in history at a certain point of evolution, that have a tendency to fall under the equation of this circumstance or condition is happening to you because of X, Y, and Z. Somehow you're to blame for something. That's always the equation is, how can I blame myself for the things I don't like? What did I do wrong? What did I not learn from my lesson? You ever have that one? Let me hurry up and figure out what life's trying to teach me so I can get the hell out of this discomfort and frustration and pain. Right? Only the ego, as crafty and beautiful as it is, can use learning as a form of spiritual avoidance. Let me hurry up and learn so I can get the hell out of here. What do I got to do? What karate move? Forgiveness? Acceptance? Let it go? Yeah. Yeah. That one gets stuck in there for some reason. I don't know how the let it go one got so stuck in there. That's like the gum on the floor of the movie theater that we all step in. You don't see it, but you know it. Oh, there it is. That's way in there. Let it go has nothing to do with declare what you are. I am the light I am. Those are the words. Those are the activating sounds of consciousness realizing its perfection. Those are the words that without having to say anything more than I am the light I am, you simply saying what you are is forgiving yourself for forgetting the truth of your being and forever being under the assumption that you are anything else other than the light of divine perfection. True forgiveness, I am the light I am, end of story. How do you forgive someone else? I am the light I am. You declare the light within yourself, that activates the light of remembrance in someone else, because obviously someone who has harmed you has forgotten their true divine nature. So how do we help a hurting soul that only hurts others to process the hurt they can't deal with? We declare our divinity to awaken it in them. I am the light I am. Someone's nice to you? I am the light I am. It is your light masquerading in a different body that is doing something nice to reflect your own God consciousness to you. But it doesn't go the other way. Good deeds is your own godliness reflected to you. Other people's ill patterns and temperamental dispositions and unconscionable actions do not reflect anything wrong within you. You only think that's how the mirror teaching is because you have a tendency to think, I'm less than the light, I'm other than the light, I'm used to finding things to work on, so let me make other people's moments of irredeemable behavior and make it about me. No. No, ma'am, no, sir. I am the light I am. It's the answer to any spiritual question you have. Why was that person rude to me? Because I am the light I am. That's why. I just listened to that person talk for 10 minutes. They didn't give a crap about me. Why? Because I am the light I am. That's why. I'm not coming from a position where I'm saying only the light is real, anything in form is an illusion. I'm not saying that. That's not even a part of the deepest teaching. That's a misunderstanding. Because in an egoic perception, in a dualistic reality, there has to be truth and falsehood, right? Here's what's right, here's what's wrong, here's what's true, here's what's false. And on a social level, that's good to have on a certain level. To organize society, to teach children about decision-making. It's all appropriate. But on a spiritual level, there isn't truth and falsehood. Falsehood is just a belief that there's something other than truth. Falsehood is just calling something something less than because it's not acting the way you want it to be. Everything is divine perfection at various levels of maturity, at various levels of realization. And when a divine being has not realized its divine true nature, its behavior is suspect and sketchy. God is awesome, but God can be sketchy. You ever notice that? Sketchy things going on. And that's another reason why you will never be on trial at the end of this lifetime. How are you going to be on trial for all the things the divinity within you chose to do? There isn't a trial. There was a trial. I'll teach you how to win. In 5 minutes, you only need one piece of evidence. You just go get one of them calendars. And you say, Your Honor, right? Heaven, Your Honor, lovely courtroom. Thank you for having me. If I can refer to Exhibit A, if I may. Exhibit A. This calendar says, they're not your footprints. I carried you all along. So it seems to me that the Lord Almighty, praise the Lord, dressed up as me, did some sketchy ass things, and is now questioning me about the things that the Lord did while dressed up as me. So maybe I got some questions for the Lord. You see what I'm saying? You think you're going to answer to any of this? You're not. There's no trial. That's just the reason why there's this feeling of trial is because when consciousness awakens, ego is what unravels. And there's no trial. It's just as your consciousness awakens, you start to look back on your life and see things from a perspective you didn't see before. And when ego starts to unravel, it feels exposed. And we start to have this feeling of regret of, oh my God, why didn't I see that back then? Because we start to access retrospect and we have greater perspective. That's the trial. There is no real trial. There isn't. And if there is, bring the calendar. Bring the calendar. Not your footprints. I carried you all along. So let's ask, hey, God, why did you dress up as me and make me an accomplice to something I did not know was going on? See what I'm saying? Why did you create me to respond to hormones? Now asking me why I acted upon said hormones. Why did you create me in a world of rather beautiful people with a body of hormones with the choice to choose these things if this was not what I was supposed to do? If you really think about it, things don't make sense. I got questions. Hey, God, why did you dress up like an anxious little dog that my family bought for me that humped my teddy bear when I was a kid? Why'd you freak me out? Why'd you freak me out? Thought the dog is my little friend. Only to destroy my teddy bear. I got questions for God. Hey, God, why'd you bring me to a planet with such delicious food? Why is digestion so weird? What's up with that? Right? Seriously. So just, I know I'm a little off topic, but just... I just want to get across
that there's all night.
There's no trial. There's no trial. There's no trial. Hey, God, why did you put me in summer camp around a beautiful, beautiful angel who saw the light in me too, and we walked in the moonlight with butterflies in our belly like an episode of The Wonder Years? And just when we were about to have that first teenage kiss, then you come dressed up like a swarm of bees. Messing up my game, God. What you doing? Does God like not have an attention span? He goes, oh my God, you know what'd be really funny right now? No, you know it'd be awesome if you just let things play out, God. Right? You create everything, what, in 6 days? You need more than one day's rest, apparently. Let's just stick to the game plan. Everything is divine perfection. And there is no trial. It's that the ego feels exposed as consciousness wakes up in it. And there's this period where the ego is still intact and the light of consciousness is awakening in you and you're having all these perspectives, all these clarities. You're looking at things in retrospect. Oh my God, if I knew this back then. And when the ego feels exposed, there can be regret, there can be shame, there can be guilt. And there is this period of time where the ego is still intact and consciousness is awakening. And with all that expanded awareness and with the ego that only knows how to live by feeling bad about itself, it can lead to some rather deep self-judgments and self-hatred. It's very deep and very serious. That's why I teach more love, not less. Because it can be so hard. It can be such a hard crash landing when you start waking up, like as if you have been, like you've ever had an experience of someone, maybe a family member, and I'm not making light of this, but like people that have, you know, gone on a drinking binge and, you know, when people get intoxicated, they don't act like themselves. They think it's like their best qualities. But if you're on the outside, it's a different story, isn't it? If you're on the inside of the tornado, I guess it looks different. But on the outside, it's rather different. But imagine ego being like you being completely drunk for like your entire lifetime. And then you instantly sober up and look at the mess of the life that had happened, that you weren't aware that was happening. And you become aware of the things you've done, the people you think you've hurt, and all of these things. It can be very painful to go, wow, I've now realized what I've been doing and I wasn't aware. But you are the light of perfection that can wake up out of these levels of hell and purgatory, not by trying to clear out the things that are wrong with you, not trying to do things right each day and, you know, hold life against yourself, hoping if you can do everything right, then you'll give yourself the prize of self-love. Not having a list of, here's what I'm going to try to not do wrong today, right? Negative reinforcement. I'm going to not think, I'm going to not be in the past, I'm going to not do this. And there's all these things that people try not to do. And all that does is make the light of your divine perfection seem further and further away from you. And we end that today with, I am the light I am, which means if you know and can trust the light that dwells within you, that walks beside you, the darkness will part in your presence. I am the light I am. I've had personal experience years ago where I was in the middle of a confrontation with someone who was just looking to pick a fight, and telepathically, silently, all I said in my mind was, I am the light I am. And in mid-sentence of their anger, they stopped and burst into tears. Because any person who is not being nice or is treating you unfairly, it is their soul saying, I am only putting you through the pain to share with you what I can't reconcile in myself. And I'm coming to you, a more evolved being, begging you to remind me of the truth that I am. And we respond with, I am the light I am. I will reflect your light back to you, and I will free you of your pain and your hell so that I can be spared in your presence. That's service. I am the light I am. And all of us have either gone through or are making our way through one hell or another. Whether your hell is a diagnosis you can't seem to shake, whether your hell is a mind that seems set on self-defeat, whether your hell is looking at the political or environmental climate of your world and things looking like they're going to get worse before they get better. Whatever hell you're in, the light always comes back for you. And you are the light going back in time, back into the darkness to reclaim parts of yourself that have innocently gotten lost in the dream of your own eternal perfection. And we reclaim these parts, and we reclaim our power, and we reclaim our wholeness, our holiness, simply by declaring, I am the light I am. And with the perfection of words, which is a manifestation of divine consciousness, you cannot choose to anchor and affirm your true nature and have a problem at the same time. Anything other than I am the light I am is just becoming aware of some sort of problem, difficulty, or adversity. The only difficulty and adversity, the only thing that manifests difficulty and adversity is a climate where the truth is not declared on a regular basis. What can be the only remedy and solution for any adversity? I am the light I am. Speak the truth that dwells within it. You try to overcome the mountain, and it only gets bigger and bigger and more difficult to scale. You simply stand in front of the mountain, declaring the holiness, the truth that dwells within the mountain, that dwells in you, and the mountain moves out of your way. A master doesn't climb a mountain moves out of the way of a master. A spiritual initiate grows weary and tired trying to scale a mountain while being guided by a master that knows no mountain whatsoever. I am the light I am. Your path of awakening is your journey of being Christed, awakened as the light. And at a certain point of the journey, not talked about that often, there's really two choices you have. You either begin declaring the light that you are, whether you feel it, know it, believe it, or anything. Because this isn't really a feeling. It goes beyond all that. So this isn't like a fake it till you make it kind of thing. right? This isn't that at all. This is the light is all things. The light is no thing in particular. The light is not tangible in the way that we think it is. So to say, I don't feel the light, is just one who objectifies the light to be a feeling that you just don't feel very often. Now, isn't that a fun setup? I think I'm separate from the light because I imagine the light to be exactly the way I'm not. Well, that sucks, doesn't it? That's how we fool ourselves. So it's not a feeling, it's not anything. And yet every and any feeling is that light too. But we just declare, I am the light I am. Because you either declare that you are the light, which is you freeing yourself from hell, awakening that remembrance for the well-being of all. Or do you know what you subconsciously do in your life? You spend time wondering and waiting for death while preparing to apologize for a trial that will never happen. You either declare the truth or you prepare to apologize for the nothing you've done wrong. Even just one utterance of I am the light I am, liberates you from anything you hold against yourself, liberates you from anything that you think you've done wrong. And the balance of this is I'm not suggesting that we don't live in a world where there is wrongdoing. I'm not saying that either. I'm not saying there is no wrongdoing. I'm saying I am the light I am exterminates the possibility of wrongdoing. If the world stopped for one moment and said, I am the light I am, in whatever native tongue and language is indigenous to that being, one moment, if the world stopped and declared that, every misfortune, every pain, every threat lurking on this planet would cease to exist. So we are only doing this in such a radical, deliberate way to create the tipping point for the world to join us in this angelic choir of divine declaration. I am the light I am. You either declare the truth to yourself silently, or if you have the audacity, out loud, casually, conversationally, at a party. Oh, pleasure to meet you. Who are you? Hello, I'm the light I am. Pleasure to meet you. I'll tell you a funny story about that. Just because I was at a party and I was kind of at that point of like, you know when you're at a party and you're talking to people and you find yourself kind of just needing to spice things up a little bit? I had an experience. I'm like, I'm going to spice things up a little bit. I thought, let's be different. And someone came up to me at this function I was at, and they said, oh, I wanted to come meet you. I said, oh, okay. Hello. Pleasure to meet you. They said, yeah, someone told me that you're really successful. Wow. I said, well, and again, this is me just wanting to spice things up. I go, well, I am pretty successful. They said, oh, what do you do? I said, well, I'm a trust fund kid. I want to spice it up. Really? I said, yeah, my dad is really, really, really wealthy. They go, oh my God. I said, he's like the wealthiest of all. They go, who's your dad? And I said, God. So if you're a child of God, cash in your trust fund now. Let's have some fun. I am the light I am. What did they say? They just looked at me. And they were kind of like, you know when people get like mesmerized, but they like hang on one thread? So God, your dad? Yes. Yes, God is my dad. Yours as well. Not an only child, you know.
That's why it's our Father.
Our Father.
Who art in heaven.
Our Father, Mother. Just to cover all bases. Our Father, Mother. Mother, Father. And if that's not right, take it up with God. Do you feel the liberation in this? It's amazing. Because we have to get to the essence of truth. And again, it's not wrong to have a problem. When egos take it, and again, when I say egos, I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean, there's a tendency for ego to hear a teaching and to say, how can I use that to feel bad about myself? Oh my God, I was just focusing on a problem, and oh my God, I didn't see it as the light of perfection. Oh my God, I'm totally not blah, 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 enlightened, you know, whatever. It's not what this is about. It's about your perception of problem is as much a manifestation of divine perfection as the solutions you seek. And why wait for more preferable circumstances before going a little gospel and declaring the truth that dwells in all things? And people say, so Matt, if I declare the light of all things, will that make the good things in my life come faster? No. No. All things in your life are meant to occur at the exact, precise, measurable moment of time it's meant to happen. And you can do whatever you want to do with your time between the things that come to you, and then when things come, you go, see, look at that. It was all that stuff I did. But here's the perfection, because people will hear this and go, well, if doing this doesn't make the good things come faster, why would I do that? That's what an ego would say, right? The ego wants to turn a spiritual practice into a cha-ching machine. A cha-ching machine. Wants to figure out how to hack the universe. The real law of attraction is not do your special dance, do your special karate, do your performance, and when you've impressed the universe enough with your flawless performance, life will throw you some crumbs. That's not law of attraction. Law of attraction is you only attract the things that are helping you evolve into the realization that you are divine perfection already. Therefore, true law of attraction is a journey of humility and of faith with you and the universe, not what have I done wrong to make my life so uncomfortable and what do I need to do differently to sweet talk the universe into giving me more cash and prizes. So Matt, if I do this, will this give me more of what I want? I don't know. What you really want is the remembrance of your divinity. What you really want is not more things molded out of divinity, but you want to be one with the divinity already residing in all the things you try to seek, grab, defend, protect, and further reject to make room for more things. I am the light I am. In wholeness, in wellness, in perfect health, or under the duress of endless misfortune. I am the light I am. For better or for worse, I am the light I am. For richer or for poorer, I am the light I am. Till death do us part, I am the light I am. Right? Familiar, marriage vows. The vows you take to be true and dedicated in your monogamous relationship with your own divinity. Or it becomes a marriage that is broken apart by an adulterous affair you have with your own ego. Which is normal and natural. And eventually we get it right. So why not get it right right now? I am the light I am.
I am the light I am.
No matter how I feel.
No matter how I feel.
No matter what I think.
No matter what I think.
I am the light, the light I am.
I am the light, the light I am.
No matter what happens.
No matter what happens.
No matter what comes and goes.
No matter what comes and goes.
I am the light, the light I am.
I am the light, the light I am.
No matter how I'm seen or treated.
No matter how I'm seen or treated.
No matter how I see or treat others.
No matter how I see or treat others.
Whether I am pure in my intention.
Whether I am pure in my intention.
Or scheming with an agenda.
Or scheming with an agenda.
I am the light, the light I am.
I am the light, the light I am.
Old paradigm spirituality gives you endless karate moves to memorize. Heaven only has one requirement. Come as you are. Pretty simple. And there's all these angels outside of heaven's gate going, not until I learn all this karate. Come as you are. Remember in the dream I told you about, the door of heaven is always open. The dark souls have to enter the light under their own choice and volition. And most of those souls don't choose to enter the light. The light of an ascended master comes into the darkness and gives them the choice over and over again. And eventually, the hand is extended by divinity. And sooner or later, all of those souls reach out and grab the hand of divinity and are guided out of darkness into the light. In darkness, the torture is a tortured soul is afraid of the light, and it thinks hiding in darkness is its safe spot. It thinks going into the light is when it loses all of its identity, it loses all of its characteristics, it loses all of its flavor, it loses all of its free will. I got to do what God wants to do. I can't be myself. Not like being yourself is working out for you, you know what I mean? Tortured soul, not like you're doing a bang-up job, you know what I mean? In the shadows, screaming all the time. Not really handling your business, are you, tortured soul? I want to check out the light. Prior to stepping to the light, darkness makes every reason to turn away and be afraid of the light. As soon as it enters the light, it switches into the opposite experience, and it's the greatest wellness and wholeness and well-being you can ever imagine. And I say that from direct experience, because once you've had an experience of awakening, awakened in you so deeply, it's a sense, it's not even a feeling, it's a sense that never leaves you. It's a wellness, a wholeness that never leaves you. And from my experience when I was 8, it has never left me ever. It's a well-being you can't even describe, and you can't even articulate it to someone, you can only transmit it. That's why I do this, to transmit heaven to you, because the light always comes back, and I am simply the space where that light can come back for you. The hand of divinity is extended. You must accept the invitation and take the journey that begins and ends with one declaration: I am the light I am. And it doesn't matter if you're not sure what's going to happen when you enter the light. Doesn't matter whether you're first wanting to know if it's going to give you all the things you want. Enter the light. Or as it was said, enter the kingdom first and all these things and more will be given to you. Very wise words. Spoken by one I know very deeply. A spiritual path can be the most transformational catalyst you've ever encountered when we are focused in the right direction. Even when we talk about awakening of consciousness, we often get it backwards. Ego says, I can't declare I'm the light till I've realized it and had an experience of it. The universe says, how can you experience the light that you are until you first declare it? You have to declare that you are it so the experience can then confirm what you've spoken. That's why in the beginning there was the word. The word must be uttered first before creation can come. See what I'm saying? So you must use your word to say, I am the light I am. And then sooner or later, bing bong, wow, I'm illuminated. I'm only able to see things in color with texture, and I can see other beings because it's my eternal presence lighting up the stage. I did not know that. You must use your word to declare the truth so that the truth has permission to wake up in you. And if you're sitting there waiting for the truth to come first before you speak it, it's going to be a long, long journey. And all life can do is turn up the heat, make the screams get closer, and stick out the hand of a master that says, are you ready to enter the light? To which you will say, I am the light I am. And then you will be done. And not done as in exterminated, unraveled, extinguished, done in terms of now you are ready to live. Awakening isn't about transcending death. It's about becoming real. And those that are the most afraid of the light are hiding in their imagination. The ones that are most afraid of the light aren't real yet. They're just lost in their own imagination. So awakening is about becoming real, not about unraveling falsehood. So we either declare the light that we are, or we create rather sophisticated opinions about the things we judge as being less than divine perfection. And if that's what we need to do, that's fine. Plenty of online chat rooms for people that need to do that. Need to work that out, right? I just don't know what they're talking about. I prefer these sounds and shapes and words. I like these letters, putting them together. These are the ones I like. I don't like his letters. I like my letters. This is right. That's wrong. But do you ever like just take a moment to think about some of these teachings? Like seriously, the ego wants what it wants so bad. Like the ego is like, here's the best analogy, like a Wile E. Coyote in The Roadrunner. The Wile E. Coyote character wants the Roadrunner so bad, it's going to do anything ridiculous that's not going to work just at the chance of getting the Roadrunner. The ego will do anything spiritually wacky if there is a chance it's going to get what it wants. You ever seen that? Like the Wile E. Coyote that created like this tight rope from boulder to boulder, put on a helmet with like a wheel on its head, did a headstand and tried to wheel across. Shocking, it didn't work out. You know what I mean? Shocking, that didn't work out. But on a spiritual path, we are willing to do the most wacky things if there's a chance it's going to give you what you want. Time to reclaim your power. When are things going to turn around for you? When they do. When they do. Matt, do you have like a times table? No. No, I don't. Well, then what do I do until then? I am the light I am. You see? Here's something very beneficial. Spiritual evolution does not actually begin until you are ready, even for just one moment, to put aside what you want. Ain't that a bombshell? Where most people are trained to believe that spirituality is how I get what I want. And I'm here to tell you that true spiritual progress occurs the moment you are willing to take your attention off of what you want for just one moment and ask, life, what do you want from me? And life says, use the voice you have been given and declare the truth of your being for the well-being of all. I am the light I am. Do you want to know why a lot of beings don't have what they want? Is to give them space to unravel the beliefs that they are the cause of not having the things that they want. Why would the universe bring you what you want just for you to maintain a false belief that you're either the cause or the blame for what happens in your life? How could the universe support giving you what you want by keeping you at a level of consciousness that's completely outdated and false? You are not the reason why adverse things happen. You are not the reason why good things occur. Those are simply your journey. But here's the good news. Here's the remarkable news about this. The more you allow I am the light I am to be a silent prayer, a meditation, to be like what you say as you pass by people in traffic. Use any reason to say it. Make into a song. Make it your newest jingle. Say it so often that that's just what arises in your head, like your own mental ringtone. And here's what's amazing. Because all things in our lives, whether you are someone who is dealing with an illness to whether you are someone who wins the lottery, all those things are predetermined. But what's not predetermined, what is up to your will and your choice, is how worthy or unworthy you will experience all the things that are meant to be. So imagine you're already meant to meet your soulmate, but you will determine how worthy you feel of their love or how totally insecure you become in their presence. So you will always have the right things and the right experiences, but you will decide what version of you receives it. Isn't that interesting? So I am the light I am, doesn't make the universe into your cosmic slot machine. It makes you worthy enough to appreciate everything as a gift and to allow the most perfect version of you to be the benefactor and recipient of all the things you're already destined to receive. You will either allow yourself to feel worthy of the goodness of life, or you will be given all the things you've always wanted and you will use it to torment yourself. There is choice. You play a very important role in all this, but we have to be clear on what that is. You're always taken care of in one way or the other, and life will give you as much room and space as you need to unravel the beliefs you maintain that I am the reason why negative things happen. I am the cause of goodness in my life, neither which is true. You are merely the one who decides how worthy or unworthy you become in the presence of your most immaculate evolutionary journey. And how many years, how many lifetimes have been spent contemplating why these things happened, with the only answer you keep coming up with is somehow I'm the reason. I'm the one to blame. And all life is doing is giving you more room and space to work that crap out. Till eventually in the middle, you have a holy shit moment. And in the midst of a sentence of thinking, oh my God, it all started back when I was this age, and I think it's because I did this, and of course, because of what I did wrong, and you know, I was a five-year-old kid, and of course, I wasn't holding a high vibration, and it was very ungrounded. And in the middle of that swirl, something stops. There's a glitch in the record, and all of a sudden there's just spaciousness, and out of spaciousness comes the hand of divinity that says, if you trust and allow the light that walks beside and dwells within you, the darkness will part, to which you say, I am the light I am, and out of hell you go. And when that's the gift that you allow yourself to receive in this moment, that will be a merry freaking Christmas, won't it? Yeah. A happy freaking holiday. Yeah. Feliz Navidad. And a happy Hanukkah, a merry Kwanzaa, a super rad winter solstice. And an epic Festivus for all you Seinfeld lovers. Isn't that truly amazing to realize that? Like, oh my God, I'm in charge of how worthy I am of the things in my life. Like, how many of us are in, like, some of us are awaiting that big relationship, right? And there's the belief of, once the person shows up, I'm going to magically be on my best behavior. And I'm going to somehow like being in my own presence. And I'm going to do everything perfectly, and it's only because they're not here yet, right? Nice one. Right? And you're like waiting for the person to show up to give you the permission to be who you think you're going to be. Then they show up, you're like, why can't I let them in? Why can't I be who I am? Right? And you realize your behavior, I'll even say, your vibration doesn't determine what happens to you. Your vibration determines how worthy or unworthy you are in receiving that. I mean, let's just take one moment. Like I said, spiritual evolution occurs in the moment you take your attention off of what you want for one moment. And that's an amazing baseline, isn't it? And let's just contemplate some of this kind of information that just kind of gets in there. You don't have what you want because of your vibration? What the hell's that? Have you ever thought about that for a moment? You are a light being, but because you are not at a certain frequency, you don't have the things you want. Does that feel good in your body? If it doesn't, it's not true. No, Matt, if you want, you have to be in alignment with it. How can the one who desires not be in alignment? You want what you want. You're aligned. You're aware. If you're supposed to be in alignment with the things you want, why weren't you created in alignment? Does that make any sense to you? The truth is, the more aligned you are in your divinity, the more worthy you are, which means you allow everything to be a gift, and it's not you trying to make everything a gift, it's you naturally see things as a gift because you are worthy. You are confident, not arrogant. Arrogant is comparison. Confidence is I am the light of the universe. It's my natural state of being, not something I've achieved. It's just the way it is. We're all the divine, and we're all here dealing with it. Alignment is, I am aware that I'm the light. I am worthy of receiving the goodness of my light. And the things that come to me, good, bad, or otherwise, are received by the most worthy version of myself. Does that make more sense? You're going to be given a lot of amazing things. The question is which you will receive it. Someone who prays to win the lottery, then they win the lottery. Seems like that was an intuition, right? Then they have all the money they've been begging for, only now of afraid of all the people that will come looking for them. Now afraid of all the taxes they're going to pay because they have more money. Oh my God, I have more money and I got to pay bigger checks. What you want will not make you happy, aligning with your highest worthiness to receive everything as the gift inherently is. That makes you happy. So this is about worthiness. Some of us are in relationships. Some of us are in relationships where we are with people that are our perfect compatible partner. Are we totally receiving and letting that in? Or are we like checking out from the relationship and like hiding in our mind trying to figure ourselves out? Getting what you want is destiny. receiving what you're given, taking it in and being worthy of it. That's the nature of your choice. You decide how worthy you are of the things that come to you. And in order to become the most worthy recipient of your divine evolution, we simply return to the magic of our own true nature. I am the light I am. I am the light I am. Try it.
I am the light, the light I am.
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 And when you declare that, do you know what you no longer are? A watchdog and a whistleblower for darkness. Because those that sit on the sidelines and watch and trace the every step of darkness and then report back to their people, okay, totally, do you know what's going on right now? Holy crap, there's this stuff going on, it's all crazy. It's all crazy because life is giving you things to track and trend in the absence of I am the light I am. It was literally a 2-second conversation I had with someone. Someone came up to me and goes, Matt, are you totally aware of what's happening on the infrastructure of the democratic level? What's really going on? Yes. Yes, I am. Why is this happening? Well, because I am the light I am. That's why. Just answering a prayer with a blessing. Every problem people have is a soul reaching out to God with a prayer for help. And I am the light I am, is the blessing of God within you that answers that call. You can feel the energetic holiness right now. You can feel that. And you know what this is? This is you are becoming aware of all you've been given, and you are tasting and sensing the vibration of heaven because you dare to do one thing tonight. And that is for one moment, take your attention off of what you want. You have the right to want whatever you want. Don't stop wanting. Just have some time in your life, have some space. Have some time in your life where you spend one moment at least taking a coffee break from what you want. When you do, this is what arises: heavenly perfection. That's kind of like the look you have. It's kind of like, I don't know what this is, but it feels pretty good. Someone goes, hey, what's that? I don't know. Not my footprints. I don't know. I'm being carried all around. I don't know. Is it like a piggyback carrying you all along? Does God have like a kangaroo pouch? I have questions. Like a camel ride? The energy you sense right now is just me reflecting what is always within you. And if you could simply spend time, if you could dare to go about your life Is that what you want being at the forefront of your consciousness? This is what would move you in every moment. It's already what moves you in every moment. You just may not be aware of it. So how do you become aware of what you already are? Like this. And another weird moment of introspection, if what you want is somehow somewhere you're not, how do you know you need it? If what you want is always somewhere else, maybe there's another conspiracy going on. And maybe the resolution of that conspiracy is simply, I am the light I am. And I share this with you because these are the words that I speak most often in my living communion with the universe. For me, it started many years ago, and the one who would say, I am the light I am, collapsed and disappeared. I went for a walk around a neighborhood. And I literally wasn't trying to do anything. These things just happened to me. And like I was walking around my neighborhood, and the person who started the walk never came back somehow. I remember the step it happened. I took a step in my neighborhood, and without even knowing, it's like I somehow stepped out of myself. Matt went for a walk, and Matt never came back. And the fact that I still respond to that name is the endless compassion and grace of the universe. To be the almighty light that you are and still respectfully respond to the name that I was given. Matt, yes. Yes. You called? You rang? It's a play. But only when you start playing for real. I am the light I am. I am the light I am. And for me, it's an embodied transmission, whether I'm with you or not. Every breath is a silent transmission of I am the light I am. Anything I put my attention to without even trying is transformed by I am the light I am. This will happen for you too. And I already know, whenever that fateful moment comes, when this body is ready to move on, some people go, no, you discard the body, the soul moves on. Well, sometimes. When you ascend, it's different. Cryptic. But when that moment comes, I will tell you, like I knew in a vision years ago, the last words I will ever utter in this dimension, when that time comes, I am the light I am. And it is my honor, my joy, my greatest desire, my deepest honor, my highest privilege, to awaken that in you. And every time we come together, it's a different flavor, a different angle, a different depth. So that this heavenly choir of angels can start expressing the melody of evolution for all beings in all dimensions. I am the light. The light I am. I can feel this entire room, and I can feel that you are sensing the perfection of this. the perfection you sense and you witness that animates itself as this character you see me to be is merely your own perfection calling you home. I know who I am. Do you? And if so, I am the light I am is the recognition. And if not, I am the light I am is how we figure things out. You are literally feeling the energy right now that people who have out-of-body experiences or near-death experiences, when they leave their body and there's a tunnel of light, this is what they feel. This is what you feel when you leave your body when death comes. This is the light. This is what it is. And if this is the light that people sense after death or as death unfolds, and as you're sensing it right here, right now, I'll just give you a little seed for a teaching. I'll do it a future time. Do you know what that makes this? The afterlife. You only worry about dying when you're waiting to be born. Awakening is the process of becoming real. This is the afterlife. This life is life review. You don't watch it on a screen, you jump in and live it out again.